Welcome to Tri State Fellowship this morning. Please join us in sing and worship. Welcome.
You make me brave. No fear. crashes over me, for you are for us, you are not against us, champion of heaven, you made a way for all to enter in.
Time, we're going to take a break, take 5 minutes, greet each other, and get to know another, get some snacks in the back. We'll see you in 5 minutes.
I am spent. I am filled with much regret from what I've done, from where I've come. What I owe is above my head, and my account has
Welcome you. We welcome you today. It's great to have you in here today. It's nice and warm after a week of struggles. But the Lord didn't call us to live in Buffalo, so you know we're in good shape here. We're doing all right. You know, we're really, really doing okay. So we're thankful you're with us today. want to make you aware of some of the things that are happening. Our youth groups meet tonight. The middle school and the high school groups both meet this evening at 6 o'clock. You will also note today in the newsletter that you have several inserts of interest. There's one about a women's ministries cookie exchange. So women's ministries getting so much more active, doing all kinds of different events and get-togethers. So ladies, be a part of that. So check that out for some information as well. You have From the Inside Out, which is sort of an occasional newsletter we put out there 5-6 times a year. Kind of looks back and talks about some of what's happened at Tri-State. And we give it to you as a resource to say to someone, hey, you get talking about your church, well, hey, here's some of the stuff that happens at our church and how we're seeking to serve the Lord where we are. We've had this Operation Christmas Child shoebox campaign that's been going on. It's going on all over the world. 9.9 million shoeboxes around the world, about 7.5 million of them from the United States, are put together, is the estimate for this year to be given in third world contexts around the world. We have about 900 that have been brought here by people just driving up and dropping them off all week long. Today, from 12 to 3 is a time when you can still bring them, and also tomorrow from 11 o'clock in the morning till 1 in the afternoon, and that will be the end of it, as they'll be packed up, sent on to the up the chain, as it were, to the next place before it is moved out to around the world for this Christmas season. Well, speaking of the world, we're interested in what God is doing in the world, in our world. As it says in Acts, about having a heart for Jerusalem and Judea and Samaria and beyond, those concentric circles. And of course, we have our ministry here. We have ministries nearby in varied youth endeavors and Young Life and Youth for Christ and those sorts of things. We have other ministries around the country and then those that we support around the world as we seek to be an Acts 1:8 type of church with a passion for the world. And to do that, we give our resources to the Lord, and let's pray and ask God's blessing on these resources as we take our offering today and collect them for God's use around the world. Father, thank you that we can be an Acts 1:8 type of church with a heart and a passion for those around us, those who come in who are hurt and lost, and may we be a place of renewal and healing for them. And may it be, too, that we're mindful of the people that are near us, nearby, and surrounding communities. And we pray that you'd increase and prosper our vision to reach some of these nearby communities in the next year or two as we grow in that direction. Father, too, we pray for these varied ministries in our county, in our community, in our region, in our country, and beyond that, of course, to folks like Carla Mike Kutika and Carol and others who around the world have come from here and are out there serving in third world contexts and varied places far from us. Bless them today, those who have met, those who are yet to meet, and grant them great success for their labors and their ministries where they are. So thank you that we can be a part of all of this. So as you supply for our needs, we give you thanks and ask your blessing on these gifts in Jesus' name. Amen. We have a Christmas outreach that's coming up, and this will be the main thing that we are talking about the next 3 Sundays. Actually, it's counting today as the first of those 3rd, because it's 2 days, 2 weeks rather, I should say, from today that we have How I Met Jesus. It's a program here at 6 o'clock. The Daniels have been a leading part of this. Come on up here with me, Joe and Cassandra, and they're going to share a little more about you. Let me tell you a little bit about what the program itself is going to be like. And we're going to have a total of 5 songs that opens up with a group of a handful of our teens and several children who are going to come out with a hopping song about you can't have Christmas without Jesus, you can't have Christmas without the cross, and it is a rocking song. And then there's another song of Country Boys, it's called. It's about the shepherds and how the shepherds were just, it's like a country song. They're just country boys, and the kids with straw hats, and it's going to be great fun. And then the program, and there's a little sketch, kind of skit thing that's going on, just a two-person thing. The setting is downtown Hagerstown, and we'll be talking, and it turns a little more serious. There's a solo by Genesis, who's singing here today with our youth band, and then an adult choral group, which are kind of the choraler, you know, the carolers who sort of show up, and a couple of songs, a total of five songs. There'll be a testimony, a very powerful testimony of God's grace, and then it's a 30-minute video, is it right? A 30-minute video from the Billy Graham organization. So, Joe and Cassandra, tell us a little more about it from your preparation.
Well, it's very important that we begin and continue to think about those in our world that would benefit and would want to hear about the story of Christ's birth and as it relates to just salvation in our own lives. And we did, we have a card here that should be in your newsletter that is an invite card. It's designed that you can give it out to your friends and family that will just tell you when the service is. So I'm going to encourage you to give those out. Have it in there?
I had this from earlier in the week, so my particular folder might
there
be was, deficient.
They were in there last week.
Okay.
So I hope they're in
we
this
have
week.
Them in the back. If
some
we don't.
In the back
adult ministry table. In the back.
So grab mm-hmm. them. You may hand them out. They have the details about the service, and also will encourage you to remember to invite the people in your top five.
That's right. Now, last week, you might have received a card like this with five slots on it for five names. And what we really want to encourage you to do is just to pray for these people. Because those of us who know Christ, we weren't smart enough, we weren't good enough, we weren't whatever enough to know him. God somehow got into our lives because somebody prayed and somebody was looking out for us. So we encourage you to pray because it's God's work. And if we pray, then we know that he's in it. And that it's not something that we're doing ourselves. We would also like to just remind you that the event is on December 7th, and keep praying. Okay, all right. We're just gonna say a prayer for you guys. Let's pray. Lord, we just thank you that you love us, that you took initiative and entered our lives, and that you used other believers to do so. And Lord, we want to be those believers. We want to reach out to our friends and acquaintances, and yet it's something that requires a lot of courage just to even invite somebody or let somebody know that, hey, there's an event coming that is really special, and I'd like you to come along. And Lord, just give us boldness, give us strength, help us to be the those who reach out, and help us to begin the conversation with you and to grow deeper in our prayer life with you as a result of reaching out to others. And we just thank you for giving us this opportunity. Amen.
Amen. So we really do want you to be bringers. Think about people around that need Christ and bring them out for a time that'll be a fun evening together. I'll ask the band to come on back up front. You'll notice that with one grave exception in the far back right corner there, behind the glass, there's an old man. But the rest of these folks, this is our teens and a college kid or two up here, and so we're thankful for our youth to lead us in our worship time today, so make sure you thank them today when you see them and encourage them and for that. Speaking of youth, there's a Chick-fil-A calendar fundraiser thing. The Goodwins will be at the back, and you can see her about that. And just one other thing, speaking as well of college students, some of you have the college students coming home. There is a college dinner event on Wednesday night at 6:30. So encourage your college student to come be a part of that as they kind of reconnect with each other coming home or and those who are here in community college and so on. So it's at 6:30 Wednesday night. Call Chris just to let him know you or your child is going to be involved in that. So, hey, there's a whole bunch of things in this newsletter I didn't say. There almost always is just a bunch of stuff. So check it out. Come on. Come on now. You be a part of it. Come on. That's what he says, right? Hey, take us back to a time of worship here. Jake and Jake leading us.
Everybody stand with us, please, and sing this out.
Your love never fails.
loves and never gives up, never runs out on me. Your love never fails and never gives up, never runs out on me. Your love never fails and never gives up, never runs out on me.
Thank you.
sure we're all acquainted with people who are a bundle of contradictions in their lives, of highs and lows, people who are kind of unpredictable, people about whom you have a sense of you're not quite sure what you're going to get from them today, what kind of mood they're going to be in the next moment or so. It could be very high, it could be very low. We call these kind of a Jekyll and Hyde type of personality, and we know that some folks even have there are mental health conditions that even can contribute to some of these things that can predispose a person to kind of unpredictable behavior, be it like a multiple personality disorder or bipolar type of issue or something of that sort. Just a few years ago, my first year in college, in one of my first classes, I had a very famous professor in the world of biblical scholarship. He was extraordinarily well known. And everyone knew it was his last year before he would retire. After decades and decades of Bible teaching at my school, he was a physical institution in the institution. He was a biblical genius with an incredible depth of understanding of scriptures and theology and Bible history and culture and languages. He held major chairs of theological scholarship and positions of varied sorts in the evangelical world. And every student who came to my college was required on day one, as a part of their book purchase, to buy his Bible notes and theology notes. They came in green notebooks about 4 inches thick with all of his accumulated lifetime scholarly notes that would be a part of your required reading somewhere in every course that you would take in Bible and theology. He could at times be uproariously funny, kind of like a snarky sort of late night comedian. But yet at the same time, he was also a personality that was very easily provoked to angry outbursts. And he was not at all averse to saying, even to a girl in the class who's 18 years old and in her first college class, to ask a question and maybe he would respond with something like, "You know, that's the most stupid question I've ever heard. Haven't you read anything at all in your life about the Bible and what it teaches?" And he daily brought to class a mood that was afflicted kind of by probably kind of whatever happened in the last 30 minutes before class started. It was like going to a class with a professor being the Beast from Beauty and the Beast. Remember the Beast and how all the silverware ran around like just afraid? You don't want to get him upset, you know? And that's the way you kind of came into his class. And the worst moment of every class was the first minute after the bell rang and the class would begin and he'd take his elderly bony finger down the grade card in his grade book and he'd find a name and he'd say something like, "David Swasina. David Swasina, are you here? All right, you lead in prayer today." And terrified 18-year-old David Swasina would stand and pray. And then at the end of the prayer, the traumatized student would say amen because the good doctor would do a critique of his prayer. Went something like this: "When you pray, David, when you pray, don't hang your dirty wash out for everyone to see. We don't want to see your dirty wash. Don't do that. And when you pray, don't keep telling God who he is. He knows who he is." Things like that. And it was just terrifying. And as I look back on it now, it was totally ridiculous that this man was allowed to act and behave and carry on as he did simply because he was a brilliant scholar, though I'm sure he maybe wasn't always that way, and I'm sure that the school was just kind of waiting for him to kind of die. and move on to his eternal reward, as they were probably afraid to deal with the living institution. But you know, maybe not to that extent, but we all have a couple of sides to who we are, and to our personalities and to our demeanor and behavior. We have a side that's our natural selves, just as we are in the world, as those who have inherited a sin nature, with varied degrees of self-interest and motivation, varied degrees of times where if we give expression with no discipline and breaks to the natural proclivities of our lives, where we may very much seek to serve self and protect self and fulfill fleshly desires. And it's the side of us that over our lives has probably given us the most pain and trials in our years. But there's another side to us as we have named Christ and had the Spirit of God come to live in us, that by God's grace is one that realizes what we are. In a vast universe that he has created, we are but a speck. And due to no merit of our own, we are loved by this God who created it all. He has given us his grace in Christ Jesus. He has given us his Spirit to live in us. And in our better moments, we realize that indeed we are servants of this God who we seek to know, to worship, and to, by his power through us, be a blessing to people around us. As we look at the story of David today, and this is certainly not, you know, my first rodeo looking at David in life, but in this time going through this series on the life of David, and this is our 8th out of 8 weeks of which we are doing this series on David, I've really been especially struck in this study period of time of reading and writing and speaking on it, as Chris and I have shared these thoughts with you, been really struck by the odd mixture that is in the personality of David, of the good and the bad. He is such a mixed bag of stuff. You know, we tend to remember David mostly, don't we, for the good stuff. You know, the shepherd boy with the sheep, the musician out on the hillside with his lyre and the songs and the psalms that he wrote, the incidences of him as a young boy, or the main incident of with the slingshot and slaying Goliath as this young man of faith, and becoming a warrior in Israel who killed his 10,000s, while mere Saul only killed his thousands, to the warrior king, to being a man with the sobriquet that he was given of a man who is after God's own heart. Who else got called that in the scriptures? A person after God's own heart. Oh, yeah, but there was that thing about Bathsheba and you know, the stuff that, you know, that topic of stuff that we always, somebody around here who makes the preaching schedule always gives Chris Wiles those topics to talk about, you know, and his failure there. But, well, you know, what man's man like David isn't, you know, seduced somewhere by a total babe, you know? So now there was that incident. But what a great man, what a great life. That's kind of how we tend to look at him. But you know, his downsides are huge. There are so many problems in his life and varied failures and incidences of sin, both by acts of commission and acts of omission, where he should have done something, that is, secondly, there and stepped in, but did not. His family is a total, absolute mess. And often they're that way, we see in the scriptures, because David failed to step in and take charge, and rather he let things kind of develop on their own without leadership and stepping in amongst his very children and managing the situation appropriately. But you know, when you look at this mixed bag of stuff, there has to be some encouragement in there for us, is there not? That this person, with all these failures and sins of omission and commission, is someone that God is able to point and say, there's a man, there's a person after my own heart. And there has to be some encouragement, because as bad as he was, and man, he was bad, very bad, on more than one occasion, he got that title because the real him, the real, at the core of who he was indeed a person who dearly, deeply and genuinely really loved God and wanted to honor God and to worship God and to be God's person. That's really who he was. Is that who I am? Is that who you are when you strip it away and you get down to the common denominator of who you are? Are you a person whose heart just loves God, really loves God? Today, as we look at the last days of David's life and think about his lasting legacy through Solomon, we're going to see that our faith as well and who we are, who we really are, impacts, yes, the present generation in which we live. But that impact is one that can be felt and reverberate through generations, like even the shock waves of an earthquake as they spread out over generations. In David's last days, we see specifically three things that mark his character. We can show those to you here. First thing we'll see is that he is a man with a heart that was sometimes inclined toward his own empire rather than God's kingdom. And I'll call this the bad David, a guy who is more interested sometimes in his own strengths, in his own kingdoms. And we see negative examples of David's character in what we'll look at today, the taking of a census. And in that, we can forget that our idols can be passed down to our children. If we place trust in ourselves and our strength, our kids may see and learn and follow and become that kind of person as well as the years go by. And our sins can be then, in a way, sort of passed down by generations. But secondly, we'll see of David in the accounts we look at here today that he's a man with a heart that valued repentance and worship. And we'll call this the good David, the guy with a heart truly for God. And when he was wrong and he realized he was wrong, he was very quick to go and to call it what it was, to take responsibility fully for his actions as a truly repentant and broken person before God. And future generations likewise can learn a spirit of repentance from us when they know of, because it's usually not a secret, of our failures, but recognize our brokenness before God and the ways in which, by God's strength, we turned from our failures and sins. And those positive consequences then can ripple down through the generations. But the third point, as we speak of generations, is to say this today, that David was a man who, especially at the very end, indeed had a heart inclined toward future generations. And we'll call this the best David. David was concerned with the future succession of God's plans, of God's kingdom, God building his kingdom through Solomon. And if there's a biggest idea in it all today, is to say this, that our greatest task is not seeing ourselves succeed, but in seeing God's mission, God's kingdom succeed. Not just in our own time, but in the times that come from us. We're going to look at a couple of chapters today and read quickly through quite a number of scriptures. Go with me to 1 Chronicles today, the book of 1 Chronicles. We're going to be looking in chapters 21 and in 22. Now, these passages are also, and some of these same stories are in 2 Samuel, at the very end of 2 Samuel, bleeding over into the beginning of the book of 1 Kings. And if you'll track with us in our online readings for 3 more days, we're going to be looking at the parallel passages to those we see today. 1 Chronicles 21, where it says, Satan rose up against Israel and incited David to take a census of Israel. So David said to Joab and the commanders of the troops. So Joab's kind of like he's sort of like Arnold Schwarzkopf, okay, in Israel, all right? He says, go and count the Israelites from Beersheba to Dan. Now that's sort of like saying, let's go out and take a census of the people from Key West to Maine to Seattle to San Diego, and see how many are. So Dan to Beersheba was kind of a way of saying from the northernmost part to the southernmost part of the kingdom. I want to know how many there are, David says. But Joab, the king, this military guy, replied, may the Lord multiply his troops 100 times over, my lord the king. Are they not all the Lord's subjects? why does my Lord want to do this? Why should he bring guilt on Israel? Now, doesn't that hit you as a strange response? I mean, what's the big deal? I mean, what's the big deal about going out and counting the troops? Well, Joab knew something to be true. And here it is. Look at this passage from Deuteronomy chapter 17. Now, this is a passage, again, at the end of Moses' life, where Moses looks forward into the history, the coming history of Israel, and of how Israel would at some point have a king who would lead them. And when the time for a king came, this is what Moses said. The king, moreover, through the Lord, Moses wrote, "The king, moreover, must not acquire great numbers of horses for himself, or make the people return to Egypt to get more of them. For the Lord has told you, you are not to go back that way again. He must not take many wives, or his heart will be led astray, and he must not accumulate large amounts of silver and gold." Okay, three things. Don't multiply horses. We'll come back to that. Don't take a lot of wives. How many of the kings listened to that one in Israel? You know the history. Not many. Don't multiply gold and silver. Do you know anybody in leadership like this who doesn't do that? Okay, and it didn't happen in Israel. What does it mean about multiplying horses? Basically, what that's saying is God did not want the Israelites to build this gigantic military complex and machine. And, of course, the main implement of war was a powerful horse and pulling chariots and what it could do and the ground it could cover. And that was the way you built a powerful military at the time. What God wanted them to do was to not do that, because what he wanted them is to trust in him, that he would be their strength, that he would be the one to fight their battles, and by his strength and his arm, battles would be won and the nation would be preserved because they obeyed and trusted in him. So what this amounts to is this. The issue here is a matter of pride in self. It's a matter of a lack of trust in God that David is exhibiting here. It's like taking a perverse sort of pride and confidence in your 401k and looking at it and studying it and being really proud of it instead of really trusting in God completely. So the king's word, it says, as we read on, however, overruled Joab. So Joab left and went throughout Israel and then came back to Jerusalem. So Joab reported the number of fighting men to David. In all Israel, there were 1,100,000 men who could handle a sword, including 470,000 in Judah. But Joab did not include Levi and Benjamin in the numbering. Now, Levi was the sort of the religious leadership. That was a tribe of the priests and the religious leadership, so they weren't counted in the number. And we'll see, and it's kind of later in the story, several chapters later, the events that are going to follow here happened before the entire count could be done. That would include the tribe of Benjamin, which was historically a very tiny group and the smallest of the major tribes of Israel. So, it did not include them because the king's command was repulsive to him. This command was also evil in the sight of God, and so he punished Israel. Then David said to God, "I have sinned greatly by doing this. Now I beg you, take away the guilt of your servant. I have done a very foolish thing." Immediately David realizes, oh boy, I have really stepped over the line in a big and bad way here. Immediately he is repentant. Immediately he turns to God with his sin. And the Lord said to Gad, David's seer, kind of a prophet, "Go and tell David, this is what the Lord says. I'm going to give you three options. Choose one of them for me to carry out against you." So it kind of gives him a choice of medicine, you know, here, of punishments because of his sin. We'll skip a few verses. What David does is he chooses the one that wouldn't be the one that would give him the most comfort or separation from the sin, but he chooses the one that most puts him in God's hands rather than man's hands. And so it is a disease and of the angel of the Lord, a plague, it says. Look down at verse 14. "So the Lord set a plague on Israel, and 70,000 men of Israel fell dead. And God sent an angel to destroy Jerusalem. But as the angel was doing so, the Lord saw it and relented concerning the disaster and said to the angel who was destroying the people, 'Enough, withdraw your hand.' The angel of the Lord was then standing at the threshing floor of Araunah, the Jebusite. And David looked up and saw the angel of the Lord standing between heaven and earth with a drawn sword in his hand extended over Jerusalem. And David and the elders, clothed in sackcloth, fell face down. And David said to God, "Was it not I who ordered the fighting men to be counted? I, the shepherd, have sinned and done wrong. These are but sheep. What have they done? Lord, my God, let your hand fall on me and my family, but do not let this plague remain on your people." And so we see the bad side of David, the side of David that trusted in his own strength. But then secondly, we see this good side of David, where he immediately sees his sin, he repents, he turns from it, and goes into the Lord with it. And so we see that he builds an altar. And then the angel of the Lord ordered Gad to tell David to go up and build an altar to the Lord in the threshing floor of Araunah the Jebusite. And so David went up in obedience to the word that God had spoken in the name of the Lord. And so, moving quickly on, we see that he comes to this place, he makes a sacrifice, and what he does is he buys this. Let's skip down a bit, if you would, through the slides as I try to move along quickly to here to get through all of our our material here. Go down to verse 24. Now, previous to this, Araunah had said to David, he offered to just give, oh, here, just take it. Take this, take the animals, you know, whatever. Let me give this toward the end that this curse be broken. But verse 24, David replied, "No, I insist on paying the full price. I will not take for the Lord what is yours or sacrifice a burnt offering that costs me nothing." And there is a principle in there, isn't there? There is a timeless offer in there that when we give and sacrifice to God by the giving that we do or the ways that we step out in our lives, that we are trusting God in perilous times and not sure how things are going to turn out, but we trust in Him in it. It's easy to take someone else's money or to let someone else do something and you just kind of be in the background and sort of follow along and you gain the benefits from someone else's faithfulness or blessing. But David said, no, I need to be in the cost of it. It needs to accrue to me and it needs to come from my account. And so the Lord spoke to the angel, and he put his sword back into his sheath. And we see that this place then becomes the place that David realizes here, and there's sort of a couple of odd verses here that come up, where David realizes, though, that this place is the place that God has chosen to be where, ultimately, not just the sacrifices one time, should take place, but it should be the place which is the place of a sacrifice, and we believe that the temple was in fact built at this spot, and it was at this spot as well, it's the same spot as like Mount Moriah of Abraham and Isaac, which is a story that we're going to be talking about during the Christmas season. And so, the house of the Lord is to be here, David said, chapter 22, verse 1, turning over to the next chapter. David said, "The house of the Lord God is to be here, and also the altar of burnt offering for Israel." And so what does David do? He begins to make preparations for building the temple. Now in chapter 22, beginning in verse 2, it says, "So David gave orders to assemble the foreigners residing in Israel, and from among them he appointed stonecutters to prepare dressed stone for building the temple of the house of God. He provided a large amount of iron to make nails for the doors of the gateways and for the fittings, and more bronze than could be weighed. He provided more cedar logs than could be counted for the Sidonians and the Tyrians, people of Tyre, had brought large numbers of them and to David." And so David is not to be the person to build the temple, as we'll see in this passage, but he knows that even though he's not the one to do it, he is going to make preparations for it because of his heart for God and his heart for God's program and for God's kingdom as it moved into the future. It says, following then in verse 5, "My son Solomon is young and inexperienced. The house to be built for the Lord should be of great magnificence and fame and splendor in sight of all the nations. Therefore, I will make preparations for it." So David made extensive preparations before his death. And the rest of the chapter goes on to say, you can read this on your own, it'll be part of our devotional series in the next several days. He goes on to say, and to bring Solomon in, and to say, "Solomon, listen to me, buddy. Trust in God. Obey Him. Follow Him. Obey His word. I've made these provisions. You carry it out. you build the temple and you continue on, and God will bless you as he has promised that he would bless those who obey him, and so on. You know, like David, like everyone seeking to live the walk of faith with God, we have moments where we are the bad us, the selfish us. But then we have moments where we're the good us, where we're repentant and where we're worshipful. But like David, we need to have a goal, to have that the time that we have where we are increasingly living our lives, not just, certainly not at our worst, but not merely being good and getting through, but living as our best, being our best by having a view that is beyond ourselves and is oriented towards God's kingdom. I mean, it's easy to go through life and to putter along and work to see ourselves succeed, even in the Christian life. And yes, it's the honorable thing to do, to work hard ourselves with our lives and with our families, and to bring them to the family of faith, and to expose them to the church family, as we're told to do in Hebrews, to be faithful in this. And that serves us well, and so we choose churches based on the kinds of programs and the speaking and the children's and youth programs, and we resource ourselves and our families and all of that, and we feel good about ourselves because, you know, while we were on our shift, while we were on our shift of life, we did our job. You know, we got it done. We did the basic things. We got it done. We did well enough. But I'm telling you, folks, if there is anything that God has called me to speak to this church and to this family of faith about in these 20 years that I have been in this place and in this church, it is to call you to own and embrace a bigger vision than just being pretty good and faithful yourself with your own kids and your own family and drawing down on the resources that are here and giving back what you can, but to have a bigger vision than that. A bigger vision that looks to generations beyond. And so we talk all the time about a generational vision, to think, yes, about being faithful in your time, but to think bigger than that, than beyond that, and more and more and more to think of that. The older you get, to more and more and more, as time goes by, be used of God in your family system and the church family system, to care more and more and more about the ongoing vision of God and what is going to happen even when you're not a part of the actual unveiling and all the activity that is to be involved in the continuation of God's kingdom, to increasingly look to be a resource for others, to carry that mission beyond yourself, just as David had a heart and a passion for that. This last year, this fall season, it about killed me in my backyard. I've been at the church here 20 years now, and I've been in the house that we have for 19. We built the house there. We bought a raw piece of property that was on the edge of a woodlot, and they have like 8 acres, and like 5 of those 8 acres are a woodlot that goes kind of up a rise and to the top of a hill beyond that you can't even see from the house. But where the house is and surrounding it was basically land that probably for 200 years was behind the old farmstead that was there and was certainly most of the time used as a pasture area, perhaps once in a while as a field, but it was kind of an open. So they're building kind of a house in a field sort of near the woods. And so I'm thinking, man, we got to get some trees. We got to get some trees around this house. You know, I need some windbreak trees. So I planted like 30 cypress trees and varied types of evergreens, but I also planted, I'm counting them now, I think it's around about 30 deciduous trees, mostly maples and a few oaks. And now, 19 years later, wow, the vision has come through, and it just about killed me this year, raking leaves and dealing with that. And I've been really shocked at myself and surprised, actually, first of all, I'm not sure when I did that, I actually thought I'd be still there 19 years later. And there I am, so I got the trees. But what I'm really shocked at myself now is there are places where I look and I think, you know, we got this whole generation of trees, and there's this open spot and that spot, and there are these spots where probably I should be thinking, you know, what's going to replace those trees? And I'm really disappointed and shocked at myself and my thought process where it says, well, let somebody else worry about that. You don't need to worry about that, you know. You're turning 60 this year, this winter. You're not going to be there to see that happen. So, you know, just enjoy the trees you got there while you can, and let somebody else worry about the next generation of trees and cleaning them up. Well, the point is that this year, noting some places where I think I should be involved. I haven't been involved. And we become like that in our Christian lives, where we think about service and life and the Christian community and faith, where we can get to a point where we kind of say, I raised my kids, I served some in the church, and I supported the whole mission of it, I gave toward it, I helped a little bit here and there. Now I'm going to sit back and enjoy myself. And then along comes this really annoying New Jersey-accented preacher dude who says, no, you need to work harder now than you've ever worked before to be honorable to God in your families and in this church community. And yeah, that preacher dude guy is saying that to you. He really is. And it has not been a universally popular message in the years I've been sharing in. But let me say something real quick here before I say our final points. And that's to say, don't hear the application of what we're talking about today to only apply to you if you're moderately middle-aged as me or older, okay? It applies to every one of you. What I'm saying, though, is though that it applies to you. What I'm talking about, it applies to you more and more every day as the years go by and as the time go by. But it starts even now. And so I would say to my teen friends who are up front here, if you'll hear the application of this message today, and you will make it a lifelong plan to invest, yes, in your generation, and yes, with your little children, and raise them properly, and walking with your teens through the ups and downs and the challenges of your teenagers' lives, and if you will make a plan to be that person who goes through that your whole life with an idea that more and more and more I'm looking away from myself and I'm looking at the people who are coming along and I'm investing in more and more people in bigger and bigger ways. If you will start that now and have that as a plan in your life, you get to be 70 years old. The impact that you are going to have in your life is something you can take great joy in, and I believe that God will bless about your lives. Hey, looking back at the 3 points about David's life, let's bring them back as 3 points of application here now. The first thing is that what we want to minimize in our lives. We want to minimize a heart that's sometimes inclined toward our own empire rather than God's kingdom. That's the bad us coming out. We don't want to be that. We want to minimize that natural proclivity and tendency that's part of the resident sin nature that we still have this side of glory. We want to secondly maintain a heart that values repentance when we are wrong, that goes back to God, that continuously runs back to God, that brings our failures and brings our trials to Him over and over, and is a heart that has a heart genuinely for God, to love Him and to worship Him. But the third thing is what I want to challenge you is to go beyond that and to maximize, and that's our key word here, to maximize a heart that is inclined toward future generations. And if we'll do us, I'm telling you, that's the best us. That's the best us. And our challenge is to be patriarchs and matriarchs in our family systems. And as I said to you guys, to do it long before the end comes or draws near, beginning in early in life to have a strategy, to be a servant, serving others young in life, serving and having a plan with your children from the earliest years to know and love God, to walk strategically with your teens through their, your young adults, through the inevitable challenges that will come, and to rejoice with them and to multiply the victories in their lives of faith. And then in latter years, to think about how you can be a resource for others around you and rising generations in your own family system and in the church family system. What I'm asking you to do is to plan now, if you're not doing it, and however old you are, to begin doing it, if you're not, to be a patriarch, to be a matriarch in your family system. Not just letting things happen. Don't just let them happen. Make them happen. Living faithfully first and continuously, as more is caught than taught, honestly, we know that, but to be strategic in it all. And I look around at the Christian friends that I've had here and in other places, and I see so many who are good, godly people, but who flounder in their lives and in their family systems because they have never taken on this challenge of being a patriarch in their family system, to be a leader for eternal values and the progress of the kingdom. It's easier to just sit back and kind of let it happen and say, I kind of did what I could when I had a shot and when I was on my own shift with the kids, and well, they'll have to figure it out from here. Think about how to be a patriarch in your family system. I don't talk that much, honestly, about parenting and that sort of thing, because it's a little creepy when you got five kids. And when I came here, I had one in the high school and one in the middle school and one in the, you know, and that was the way I kept tabs on all you guys too, because I had a kid in every department. No, I'm just kidding. But now, you know, the youngest one's a sophomore in college, and I feel like I can start talking a little more about family experiences. So I'm going to share one. I'm going to pull back the curtain of the Buckman house, and it's not a nice scene, although it turns out okay. What I'm going to tell you is about somewhere around about a year ago. There was a day when a number of the boys were there, and someone said something a little snarky and unkind, and another one was offended. And so he doubled down on it, and he said something double snarky back. And then, oh yeah, well, I'll see you and raise you on that. And it got back and forth, and several of them got involved with it, and I said, that's it. That's enough. It's enough. Stop it. You sit there. You sit there. You sit there. Now, here's what we're going to do. I'm going to tell you what's going on here. You know what you said? You're wrong when you said that. You knew you were going to hurt him when you said that, and you said it anyhow. Now, that part of what you said is true, and you need to hear that. But that other part you said is not true. Now, what you said back to him, you know what? That had about half truth in it, too. And here's what was right about it, and here's what's wrong about it. And I'm going to tell you something, boys. You know why you're this way, and you know why you're acting this way? You know where you got it from? You know why you're being this way? You got it from me. That's where you got it from. I know all about this. Dad, back in New Jersey, they taught us how to insult people at the highest level of any state in the United States. Nobody can insult someone better than someone from New Jersey. You know what I'm saying? Okay? It's so creative. It's such a great skill, is it? No. It gets you in all kinds of trouble. You guys are that way because you got it from me. I got it from Marilyn. Marilyn got it from Ruth. Ruth got it from David. And you know what? It's a great resource in one way in your life, because there will be times when God calls you to be a Nathan the prophet in someone's life, and you're not going to be a wuss and back out of it. You're going to go and say, you know what? God is saying this to you, and it's going to be a great resource for you. But some other times you're going to say stupid stuff when you're not living in the Spirit, and that's what's going on here today. We need to be family together, and you guys need to fix this. You need to own that. You need to own that. You need to apologize for that. You need to apologize for that. I expect you to get it done. And over the next day or two, around the house, I could hear conversations, and then I'd hear, and people were restored, and we had our family system back. That's what I'm talking about being a patriarch in your family system. And then I got one last thing to challenge you with, and we'll close with that. Keep going extra innings here week after week. You're not going to come back if we keep doing this. That's for you next week, Tim. Oh, gosh, Tim's on next week. All right. So, hey, I have a friend, and a lot of you know my friend. He's a pastor in the community, Brian Moore, and he has ALS. He's basically had the two-minute warning in life. And you know what he's doing in the last couple years or whatever he has, he's in the midst of it, and you know, the disease is growing. You know what he's doing? He's writing life memoirs. They're fantastic. I've read a couple of them. I said, Dave Swasina has gotten them, shared them with me. Dave visits him regularly. I went with him one time, and they're fantastic. And what he is doing is he's writing stories about his life for his family to have. And what he's doing is he is teaching his family, and he's given them a resource that they can pass down over the years. Having a screwed up family that I came from, and doing some ancestry research stuff, I'd love to have a book like that that would have been handed to me. I would have loved my godly grandparents that I had. I would have loved to have heard the challenges of their life and where they came from and how they made the decisions they did and how they got, you know, all of that. That would have been a great resource I would have loved to have. I'm going to challenge you to think about doing that. Even you teenagers, think about that as life goes by. Write your own autobiography, your own memoir, with your value system, that it can be given to your children and your grandchildren, and they can have this resource that can go down through the generations. The word for today is maximize. Maximize your time to be a person of impact, a person who has a value for God's kingdom work, not just on your shift, but on the shifts to come after you, of those who will serve after you in the generations of your family. Be that kind of person. And if you do that, you can have a life that can be a great life. Yes, for you, but for God's kingdom. Let's stand and close in prayer. God, I thank you that you give us the lives you give us, that you give us opportunities to live for you. And in spite of the sin that comes to us, you give us the opportunity to be your people and to be forgiven, to live a life that's worthy, and to have as a strategy a way to be a people of impact for generations to come. Lord, by your Spirit, I pray that you move this application into each life that needs to hear it today. Dismiss us with your blessing today. Be with those who struggle. Be with those who can't be with us today. Thank you for the good recovery many are making from recent times of being set aside. Bless each one. Bless us as we continue to meet today as a family together. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. You are dismissed. You can help us by stacking some chairs around you and greet folks around you today.
I won't run. I will stay. I'm not leaving you. I know there's friction here. The struggle makes us new. I wish you never thought you had.